Today we're taking a look at the song that won my four-track contest a couple weeks ago. This is a song called Old Times by our good friend Oliver Reddy. What's up, Oliver? Thank you for sending the full version of this track for me to look at and make a video with. So everybody say thank you to Oliver in the comments. Leave lots of comments and questions if you have them. Anyway, so I want to show you guys things that I think are really interesting about this mix. Why I chose this song is pretty much because I loved the song and I thought it was very nicely recorded. He used real drums, which was, he was the only person, I believe, who actually used real drums. So I want to show you things that I like about the mix, things that I think are very interesting about the mix. And then I'm also going to address something that, is not great about the mix, something that I will show you how to fix. Last thing, it's in Logic. So you guys are going to be looking at Logic today and we're going to be going through it channel by channel. Let's do it. So here's the song in Logic, and I'm just going to push play for a little bit and we can listen to his original mix. Here we go. I just let it run all the way to the end because I love this song. I think it's a really great song. So Oliver, yeah, awesome songwriting, man. Words are good, melody's good, recording very, very good and very interesting to me, okay? So one of the things that I've noticed and I can't quite wrap my head around, so Oliver, maybe you can leave a comment about why you do things this way. But when I come over here and I check these levels, well, they are sitting all at zero, right? Zero, 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 zero. They are, the vast majority of them are sitting at zero. I don't know. It really looks like they're all at zero. Interesting. I don't think I've ever personally seen a song that was mixed sort of behind the fader, all sort of pre-fader mixing is what I would call this, right? So if I come in here and I look at the channels, and we're going to do it this way. We're going to look over here. So this is the guitar chord channel. It's like on this one guitar, right? All he has is an EQ, right? So if we push solo on here, it's just, oh, let's get to a part where it's playing. He didn't use any amp simulators. This is a microphone, I would assume some sort of like a 57 or a 58 in front of his guitar amplifier, which he has a tone that he and I both like. So he recorded a real guitar, which, awesome, always great. But it's the same thing with the other guitar, right? So one of the things that I did notice that I do always enjoy when I see people doing these kinds of things. So in this guitar part, right? So here's the EQ that we were just looking at. A lot of the low end is cut out, nothing else, right? He just basically did a high pass filter. So, you know, I don't know if that was even necessary, honestly. I mean, maybe that was totally up to him. He didn't want to hear some of that low end in there. So fine with me. But if you come up to the other guitar part, the EQ is different. I always love it when people understand that if you're doing an identical part that's left and right, that they should in fact be EQ'd differently. It helps give you that big spread out sound, helps separate those guitar tracks a little bit, you know, especially if you're doing the same microphone, same amplifier, same guitar, right? And you just play that part two times, it's always advisable to EQ one of those guitar parts or whatever doubled part slightly differently. It'll give you a bigger open sound. So, hey, great job on that. But again, really interesting about this pre-fader mixing. And that's what I call it just because it's all set to zero. Anyway, very interesting. Another thing that I really, really thought was interesting and good for my viewers to see here is, look, no compressors, right? No compressors on the guitars. We'll go down until we find one. Here's another guitar part. Here's a bass, okay? Bass has a compressor on it. This is a guitar part, right? No guitars seem, except for this part. This part does have a compressor, but for the most part, no compressor, okay? So I think not only is that super cool, but it's very, very interesting for you guys to realize you don't always need to put a compressor on stuff, okay? So if we take a deep look at like the audio itself, right, we can look at the waves here. He played it nice and steady. It's very even. There is not a lot of dynamic range out of this particular guitar part. So you don't really have to deal with peaks, right? There is no peaking moment in the entire take, right? Understand, you guys, that a compressor is really only necessary if you have a sound that is, you know, has a lot of dynamic range that you need to control and contain. And by dynamic range, I mean like it has some low parts and some loud parts. Let's just say like that. Low volume parts and high volume parts. Sometimes, and a lot of times, if there's a lot of range between the low and high parts, you will need to squish them together, you know, bring the low parts up, bring the high parts down, and try to even it out. But in a guitar part like this, totally unnecessary. It would have just gunked up the sound and the signal. It would have done something, I would assume, negative, right? So just remember that. You guys don't always need compressors, okay? So anyway, let's keep going down because I think there was, he recorded his own drums. So let's enlarge this a little bit so you can see. So he's got a kick, a sample kick, a snare, and two overheads. Let's just solo these guys out and listen to these drum parts because they're pretty good. And over here, we'll see. Yeah, EQ and compression, just an EQ. Okay, that's the sample kick. The snare. Wow, that's also interesting. See, now on the snare, I probably would put a compressor just because it's a snare. Snare tones can benefit greatly from good compression. Overall, it might not have been necessary, but let's, take a look at this snare. And he does have it grouped here. So let's look at this group. There is a compressor in the group. Let's turn that off. So when I turn this compressor off, that's in the group here, it drives the overdrive a little bit more. I think that's interesting because I don't really hear the overdrive otherwise. I mean, it's there. It's just the slightest bit of drive or overdrive there. But again, an interesting effect that he chose. Okay, so the only thing I would say, Oliver, right? That's your name. Things like a snare, and especially when there's so much bleed from all the other instruments in the room, right? So the overheads and the kick in particular, right? The only thing I would say is it might be a good idea to throw a gate in there. Oh, good. I have a noise gate. You know, and crank it up. And let's just do this. Okay, the release seems a little slow. Okay, so that's just throwing a gate on the snare, okay? Let's listen to the drums again. I'm gonna turn that gate off. Do you hear how much of a difference that makes, especially when you are like really tuning into what the reverb is doing? I'll do that again. I'll play this and just turn that gate on and off. So you can hear that it's actually sort of darkening the sound a little bit, which I think, judging by what I've seen, like if we look at the EQs here, you know, you're not really trying, this is on the snare. It's not like you're trying to get a ton of high end out of your snare drum, right? To my taste, the snare is a little bit on the dark side. I might do something. Turn that key. Wait, where am I? What am I working on here? Okay, here, I'm in this. Okay, so why is this still? What happened? Oh, I know why. because I'm not soloing the right thing. Okay, so now let's EQ that. So if you are wondering what I'm looking for here, I'm looking for two things. I'm looking for where is like the snare sounds and also where is like the body of the snare coming in, right? So as you can see right here in the around 156 hertz range, that is where this like low bump that you see right here, that's like the thud. That is the bump, the punch of the snare drum. And obviously all this stuff, basically, let's say 3K and up is really that crispy stuff. That's what I personally would like to hear a little bit more of. Okay, but that is accentuating, me turning that on is accentuating the gate a little bit. So I'm going to open this release time up a little bit. Good. Okay. So that's it. That's basically, you know, I think overall, man, I love the guitar tones. I love the voice sounds. I love the simplicity of what I'm seeing here as far as what you're using for plugins and stuff. It just goes to prove the point that if the performance is good, that like you really don't need to do a ton of work in the mixing stage. Well, you know, depending on the song, of course, but something like this is a clear indication that the things I've been teaching you over the years are true. You know, if you perform your song well, the mixing is just going to be so much more easier. I mean, even like look at the bass track, look at the consistency of the level of the performance, right? Again, you know, now there is, of course, a compressor on the on this bass track, and I can see why. It's a little bit, you know, it varies a tiny bit. It might not need it totally, but he did it, and I like how it turned out. But anyway, long story short, simplicity is really interesting about this mix. Also, it's, you know, performed well. So there you go. Okay, so I've said a lot of nice things. Now, let's do something that I did earlier that really sort of did surprise me because I think, wow, this mix is so good. But Oliver, or any of you out there, I have taught you to do this. And I'm just going to do a friendly reminder that it's always good to listen to your mixes in mono, okay? That's really going to give you a ton of information. So thankfully, the gain plugin is here. We just got to put it into mono, convert to mono. Okay, so now let's go back. Yeah, let's do it from here. And I'm going to leave this off, and you'll see it turn on, and you'll hear what's going on. So what you should be noticing, everybody, is that these guitars right here, these two at the top, the ones that are panned hard left and hard right, they basically disappear when you put the mix into mono. Now, this is, you know, one of the easiest things you can do to, you know, clarify is your mix on point or not, right? Plenty of people are going to listen to your songs in a mono source. You would be surprised. And there is a very good reason that engineers constantly talk about mixing in mono. It's just one of those things. If you can get it sounding good in mono, it'll sound great in stereo, right? So what I'm hearing here is basically mostly gain issues, okay? I don't think there's anything wrong with the, there's nothing wrong with the panning. There's nothing wrong with the tone. There's no phase issues. These were two separately played guitar parts. I think it's simply a balance issue. So, you know, what I would do is turn this on like we are and, well, to be honest, I would push all these faders all the way down to, you know, negative whatever it is, negative, where do we go all the way down to, well, negative infinity, right? Negative 90. I would pull them all down and then slowly start building it back up. Of course, I like to start with the drums on a low setting. And then I build up around that because as it stands right now, Oliver, you don't have very much headroom to work with, especially with this problem about the guitars disappearing in mono, right? But I don't want to make a whole video where I rebalance this thing because I just don't want to do that. It takes forever. So now it's on, right? Okay, let's get to where the voices are. Okay, so that's all I had to do right there was turn those guitars up. So now let's hear it in the whole mix. That's all it needed. However, if you look at where these faders are now, either, you know, down here, for example, right, we're pretty much at the top, right? These go up to 6 and we are sitting around 4. So not a lot of headroom. That's one of the reasons that I talk about trying to mix low. especially with the faders, trying to keep things down below, just so you have more room and more headroom to work with. I think, long story short, Oliver wrote a great song, performed it phenomenally well. That is why he won the contest, because the material was so strong and it was so well played, so well mixed, and it was truly fascinating to come here and look at this song from a mix standpoint, especially for me. Oliver, dude, you are on a very interesting track. I love the simplicity of it. I love that you don't use a lot of effects. I love that you're not using a lot of compressors. There might be a compressor on his pedal board or something that, you know, maybe that's why he didn't need it in the track itself. But otherwise, check it out, you guys. Simplicity is what makes this a great mix. And one of the reasons, now that I see it, I think clearly it's one of the reasons that it won, because it sounded right. It sounded natural. It sounded good, you know? He clearly didn't have to do a ton of work. All he did, and you can see them here, is just work the EQs a lot. A lot of shelving, which, you know, I don't know if it's all necessary 100% across the board here on every single guitar you seem to have high-passed. Almost all of these have been high-passed. I don't know about that personally. Like, you might, if that's something you always do, Oliver, maybe get out of that habit and understand that sometimes there's good tone in there, especially for a guitar part. Anyway, I don't want to, well, let's listen to that. Let's just turn off his EQs and see if they sound any better. In fact, I think it sounds better with the EQ off, right? So, I mean, I hadn't done that before, but I totally think this guitar tone sounds better. It's a personal preference thing. Does it sound better or not to you guys? What do you think? Does it sound better with or without the EQs on? I personally think it sounds a little bit warmer with the EQs off. With the EQs on, it's a little bit more clear and a little bit more, you know, clarity overall. I don't think there's a wrong decision there. I think it's personal preference. So, you guys, one more time, thank you to everybody who entered the contest. It was so much fun to listen to your music. You guys are all doing such a great job. But Oliver, yeah, one last time, buddy. Great, great work. So, you guys, if you have any questions about anything I've said today, please leave it in the comment below. Hey, let me know what you thought about this video. Did you like this sort of overview? Did you like this hitting some tips and tricks? I thought this was just something different. I wanted to do something different for you guys today. But anyway, you guys, thank you for watching. Please, please, please hit that subscribe button if you have not already. I'm getting very, very close to my 100,000 subscribers, and I really want that play button. Ah, I really, really want it. And of course, to all the patrons on Patreon who made this contest possible and who continue to show support for the channel, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. And yeah, sign up on Patreon, you guys. That thing is, I give away all sorts of cool rewards there. And occasionally release some exclusive content that only comes out on Patreon. And yeah, all sorts of good things happen over on Patreon that don't happen on YouTube or Facebook or Instagram. But I do have all those things, Facebook, Instagram, blah, 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 blah. Have a great day. I'll talk to you later. Peace and love.